Hands up, lift your hands high if you know that you're free. Live your life clean, cause you've been redeemed. No compromising, pleasing the king. Unashamed, Romans 1:16.
We unashamed to be different. Tell them that we're Christian. Not just tell them, but we show them.
I want to teach this morning, but I'm going to move my God to call me to move. Let's go through our scripture this morning. We're going to be in a familiar passage of scripture. Some of you may already know. It's the book of 2 Kings, chapter 4, and I'm going to be reading verses 1 through 7. And it's a very interesting story, and the thing I love about the stories of the Bible, you can apply, the purpose of the stories of the Bible are for you to apply them in your life. If you read the word long enough, you can read this scripture now, and then you can read it again, Tony, later today, and you can get something different out of it that is applicable to your life and based on your circumstances. And that's why you're supposed to constantly reread the word. And that's what the Bible means when it says you're to meditate on the word day and night. In other words, when you meditate on the word day and night, that situation may apply this morning, but it will apply to you in a different area, Kittrick, even at a greater capacity, the more you read it, because God's word is never taught. I don't care if you go to seminary, you can go and get 10 degrees, you can have more degrees than a thermometer. The word of God cannot be taught. The word of God has to be revealed. God reveals his word to you. You can read a book, but that don't give you the full meaning of what the book is. It gives you a basis for understanding the foundational principle. But the deepness of God is in the revelation of you studying God's word. And God, that's what the Bible says, for you to study to show thyself approved unto God. A workman needeth not be ashamed, rightly divide the word of truth. If the word of God wasn't to be revealed, then it wouldn't be a right way to receive it. You could receive it any kind of way. Amen. I just want to teach you on this morning. Is it all right? Amen. I might put some quarters in the meter and park a little bit as we go through this, but I'm going to break this down line by line. We're going to try to apply it to your life, and you're going to see God change your life. How many people need a change? Amen. How many people tired of coming to church and leaving the same way you came? How many people tired of dealing with the same stuff, climbing the same mountain, sliding down the same slope, swimming in the same river?
Yes.
It's time out for that. It's time for us to walk into the land that God promised us, the abundance. The promise, man. You've been promised some stuff. Get what you've been promised. I'm going to get mine. Don't be mad at me and hate on me because I'm walking in my abundance. You got the same opportunity. We serve the same God. We got the same Bible. We got the same faith because the Bible says God has given every man the measure of faith. So I have the same measure as you. What I do with mine versus what you do with yours is two different stories. Show your pearly whites or your solid gold, whichever ones you got. Amen. The word of God is good. Scripture goes on and reads this way. It says, the wife of a man from the company of the prophets cried out to Elisha. It says, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that he revered the Lord. But now his creditor is coming to take my two boys as his slaves. It says, Elisha replied to her, how can I help you? Now, first of all, when I first started reading this, I'm like, the woman just told you that the creditors is coming, her husband done died, they're coming after her for the two boys. Now you're going to ask me a question, how can I help you? Isn't it obvious? So he says, how can I help you? And before she'd answer, because I'm sure if I believe this woman was a sister. This just is not belief. I'm going to tell you why. When I look at the story and I was reading it and I was trying to get a spiritual Picasso on it, I can imagine her going to this man and saying, hey, you the man of God, you the preacher, you the one that's supposed to have connection with God, and I'm telling you that my husband, who was your servant, who was in Bible school with you, who went through ordination class with you, he died, and now his creditor coming at you, and all of a sudden he looks at her, the brother looks at her and says, Shane, he says, how can I help you? And I'm sure she did that. Rolled her little neck, and before she could get it out, he said, tell me what you got in your house. I'm sure she got the really, really hot in my house. We ain't talking about the house. We talking about this situation. But the man of God says, what do you have in your house? She replies, your servant has nothing there at all. She said, except, look at your neighbor and say, except.
Except.
a small jar of olive oil. Elijah said, go around and ask your neighbor for empty jars. Don't ask for just a few. Now, this kind of caught me because I'm sitting there like, her husband then died. Elijah was a man of God. His creditors coming after me, so obviously he wasn't a good steward over the resources God gave him, because when he died, his wife had to struggle, which is how it's going to be for me. I told the truth, when I go, I don't want her living large off me. If I die and I'm gone and she buys herself, I need her to struggle. I need her to feel my pain. I'm just playing. Y'all are like, pastor's so cold. No, I'm joking. So this man of God obviously did take care of certain business for whatever reason. Elijah said, go around and ask your neighbors for empty jars. Now, my question is, if the neighbors got empty jars, I'm asking somebody that ain't got nothing for something. So you're going to tell me the way to get what I need is ask somebody else that don't have nothing, and I'm going to have it. Because he didn't ask her. She said, all I have is oil. He didn't say, go to the house and ask them for some food. Go ask them for jars that are already filled. Go ask them to help you pay this debt. He said, go get empty jars. It said, don't ask for a few. Don't just give me a little bit of your nothing. Give me all your nothing. See, I'll take all of y'all's nothing in order to get all of God's goodness. You understand why in a little while. Because you can't feel what ain't empty. Anyway, next verse goes on and says, he says, after you get these empty jars, he said, go inside, shut the door behind you. He said, you and your sons. He says, pour oil in all the jars, and as each one is filled, put it to one side. Now, this don't make a whole lot of sense to me. I told you that all I've got in the house is one jar of oil. Now you're telling me to go around to other broke folk, get all their empty stuff, and you expect me to fill all their empty stuff with my little stuff that ain't, I got one jar, you're telling me to get a whole bunch of jars. How is one jar going to fill up all these empty jars? Don't make sense. Anyway, says she left him, shut the door behind her and her son. Sometimes when you're going through stuff, you got to shut people out. Some people ain't nothing but ear hustling to try to block what God's trying to do for you, because if it don't make sense to you, it surely don't make sense to them, so they're not going to celebrate you trusting God in this situation.
All right.
You better learn who to link up with. Some people you cannot be connected to. They will short circuit you because they ain't under the same power. You mess around and plug the refrigerator in the wrong socket, see what happens. Certain things require certain power vocals. Says, close the door behind her and her son. Said they brought her jars to her, and she kept pouring. So it says, and when all the jars were filled, she said to her son, bring me another one. Because she's seeing the miracle work right before her eyes.
Yeah.
She said, bring me another one. He says, there ain't a jar left. See, God's abundance is only limited to your agreement. The oil only stopped, Tony, because she ran out of jars. Not that God didn't run out, that God ran out of oil. Now, pause for a minute. She went and told the man of God. So if she went and told the man of God, he obviously wasn't there when she got blessed. Why do we think you got to come into church in order to get blessed? Why do you think you got to come to preach in order to get blessed? He gave her a command. She went and did it. Elijah represented God. He was the man that spoke on God's behalf. God used men of God to speak on his behalf. Elijah represented God. So Elijah, when he spoke, was God. The Bible is God to us. If you read the Bible gives you specific instructions on every situation in your life. Your job is to obey it. It isn't to come to me, well, pastor, I was thinking. Well, that's the problem. You're doing something you ain't used to. Thinking. Stop trying to think God out and trust God out. You got that? Stop trying to think God out and trust God out. So it says, he says, she goes and tells the man of God, says, what you told me to do worked. It happened. And he said, go sell the oil, pay your debts. So in other words, he said, after you get blessed, take care of business.
All right.
He didn't say, go get a new donkey. He didn't say, go. He didn't say, go get you a new dress. He said, take care of your business because you do owe.
All right.
He said, then after you pay your debt, can live on what is left. Today's topic of the message, and I already said it, is this. You can't fill what isn't empty. You cannot, look at your neighbor and say, you can't fill what isn't empty. In other words, you can't take something that's half full and then say, I filled it up, because it was never empty. All you did was top off what was already there. I don't serve a top off God. God only fills what's empty because he needs it filled with all of him, not part of him. Okay, let me bring this to this generation. Elijah represented God, right? Oil biblically represents the Holy Spirit. I would go to say this far, Kittredge, that the house in this story represented the church. Y'all can stay with me, watch this. God is saying, check this out, that because the anointing has run out in my church, the church has gotten empty. Because the church hasn't emptied ourselves from traditions, from rituals, from entertainment, from being all about money, it ain't about salvation. We've lost the premises for what the church was established for. We got denominations, which is nothing but separating God's people from being able to fellowship together. You baptize in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Ghost. We only baptize in Jesus only, so we can't fellowship. That is a lie from the pit of hell. That is not of God. God called one church for one goal, which was to glorify him, for his people to be blessed, for his people to walk in abundance, and we have emptied our vessels, and we have filled them with the wrong stuff. And God has asked us today to empty ourselves from all this worldly stuff, these worldly thoughts, these worldly traditions, these worldly mindsets. You cannot play God and play the world. God said you either have to be cold or hot. You cannot be lukewarm. Why? God said, I will spew you out your mouth. When you get spewed out, that's throw up. That's junk.
Yeah. That's good.
We wonder why we're not walking in a bunch. We wonder why things are going. The church is supposed to be the hospital for God's people to come in and get healed, get diagnosed, get prescriptions. Someone's supposed to be working on the job. But instead, our churches have become an entertainment and a social club. Who can dress the best? Who got the longest weave? Look at your neighbor and say, weave me alone. And it's not about God. So in the story, you got to understand, this woman's husband died. And he was a man of God. He had been in Bible school, and so he was trying to live the right life, and unfortunately he died, and this woman knew who to go to get answers.
Yeah.
It's nice to know that you could go into your private place, but I tell you what's also great, is when you know that there's somebody in your corner that come hell or high water is willing to pray with you, yeah, really wants the best for you, yeah, ain't trying to get nothing from you just because you got blessed. Some people only want you blessed so you can feel obligated to them. That's why they try to take credit for the prayer. Oh, it's because I prayed for you. It's because I fasted for you. Because they expect you to give them something in return. That ain't who I want in my corner.
Amen.
That's right.
You need to know that there's people around you that really want you to walk in the abundance of God, because they recognize that when you walk into the abundance, God is being glorified, and because you're generally happy for them, God is going to take care of you.
Yeah.
Just as I pray for you, I ain't expecting you to do nothing for me. My God shall supply all my needs. Ain't got nothing to do with your bank account. My God's bank account never had insufficient funds. He's never wrote a bad check. Oh, it's tight. But it's right.
Yeah, it's right.
So, this woman, creditor coming after. And see, back in the day, when you didn't pay your debt, they could come get your kids. Some of y'all like, oh, come get if that car that I got, take the kid. Take the kid, leave me the car. People got two hands up in the foot. Take all four of them. You take them. Somebody talking about they'll pack the bags. But see, back in the day, they would come and get your sons And they would come get them and put them as slaves, and they would have to work your debt off. And this woman, like, I'd have lost my husband, my support mechanism. Now this creditor's coming to get my kids. And all I got in this house is one jar of oil. That's all I got left. But how many people know little becomes much when it's in the master's hands? See, God will take your little and turn it into a lot. He took, how many fish was it? Because I don't know if y'all know the Bible. How many fish? How many loaves of bread? So you want to tell me that 5,000 people, now they had to trip that thing. Then the Bible says it was 12 baskets left over. How do you have leftovers of something that wasn't enough? But that's the kind of God. God said he'll take your little, turn it into not just enough, but more than enough. Let me twist the story a little bit more to show you how blessed you are when you're a servant of God. The 12 disciples had to serve. They had to go around and serve these people. Right? They ended up getting the leftovers. And it was exactly 12 baskets left. So God said, when you serve me, it's never written that they ever sat down and, you know how we are. We go to a wedding somewhere, and we might be helping serve, but we're going to make sure. They're running low on the salmon. Make sure you put the little salmon to the side. Put it in the back. Make sure you get me that banana pudding. Put a cup of that to the side. The disciples never had that mindset. They were operating in the miracle. And they were serving. Not even thinking about eating. Then God said, guess what? You done did your work. You done served me, trusted me that I'm going to turn little to much. Take a basket full and go home.
Yeah.
See, that's what God's trying to tell you. You can have the leftovers. How many people know sometimes leftovers are better than the main?
Yeah.
Some about the season that sets up in there. And that's kind of like the anointing. The anointing of God, when you're going through stuff and you allow that anointing to saturate in your spirit, and all of a sudden you get that power on the inside that nobody can't tell you that God ain't good. I know I don't look like I'm blessed, but I look better than what I used to. I know I ain't where I should be, but thank God you don't know where I came from. I don't have what I think I should have, but you don't know what I didn't have. You don't know what I've been through. You ain't been where I've been. You ain't. This woman in the story, the one woman, they come to get my son, this brother, after me. And he says, go borrow from somebody else. Borrow? I sat and thought, you don't think she's already asked her neighbors for help? So you're telling me to go back? And he said, yeah, you're going to go back, but you're not going back to get something they have. You're going back to get something they don't have. You're going to get something that they consider junk. I want you to go get what they consider empty. So another man's junk can be another man's treasure.
Amen.
That's right.
That's why I take your empty vessel and trust God to fill it with his anointing and watch God be glorified in my life, because the bottom line is I don't have a problem with haters. I want haters.
Right.
Y'all talking about, got to say, I take my haters, make them my elevators. No, I don't need my haters to set me up, because the Bible said the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, not by the haters. So then, I want the haters, because, see, I like to eat. I don't know if y'all can tell by this fine physique. I mean, it's hard to tell by all of this that I like to eat, but I like to eat. And so I like to have people that's talking about me. I like to have people that's lying on me. I like people that hug me, but behind my back, they're holding a knife ready to step. I like those kind of people. I like the gossipers. I like the liars. I like the back. I like all of them, because they're my haters. And I love it, because that's how I know I'm about to get blessed. God said, I prepare a table before you in the presence of my enemy. If I ain't got no haters, why God gonna prepare a table? God needs to see that he's in control. He needs your enemy to see that God got my back. Yeah, I don't have a degree, but I got the job. Yeah, I don't have credit, but I got the house. Yeah, I've been through four women. I've been through four marriages. But yeah, I don't serve a God of one chance and a second chance and a third chance. I serve a God of another chance and another chance. And another chance. That's the kind of God I serve.
Yeah.
So the woman in the story, she decided to be obedient.
All
Don't make sense, man of God. You telling me to go do this, go do this? Don't make sense. I told Shane. I said, Shane, I know you want to be married. Beautiful single woman, but go put a ring on as if you're married. It don't make sense. I'm going to put a ring on. I can marry. Seems like I'm going to be drawing people away. Don't make sense. Huh? Put a wedding ring on. I ain't married. Shane waited a little while. She went and put the little silly ring on. Something for the swap meet. I think she got from Rio Rancho, $5. Had to put the little finger up, put clear finger polish on it first, so that way, you know, your finger don't get green. But it was all good. You know, I ain't gonna put nobody on blast or nothing, but if you know it's Shane ain't sitting by herself today.
Right. Right.
Happy birthday. And I tell you what, yeah. Oh, it's a birthday, it's a surprise. And he don't look nothing like Shawnee, he don't look nothing like this. That look like a full-grown man. So she did something that didn't make sense. Trusted God. And even though it didn't make sense, she did it for a while.
Yeah.
And then God, of course, see, that's the thing. If it makes sense to you, then it ain't God.
Mm, all right. Yeah. That's good.
If it makes sense to you, it ain't God. How? Daniel gonna get thrown in the lion's den and not get bit. Now, if you don't believe me, you think you're so anointed, oh, anybody can do that. Okay. Go down to the San Diego Wild Animal Park. I want you to put a pork chop necklace around your neck. And I want you to walk over there where them zebras and them lions are. And I want you to just climb the cage. Go on the other side of the cage. Holler, Jesus. Just take your Bible with you. Try to read them some scriptures. Let's see if we see you on Sunday. But it didn't make sense. Here go these ferocious lions. Here go Daniel standing on the word of God, and they're going to throw him in the lion's den. And the Bible said that he ended up sleeping on the lion. God allowed you to rest on your enemy. Your enemy ain't got nothing to do but sit there and allow you to be comforted, because they can't do nothing about you. They don't realize, my mother, that no matter how much they try to get you, God already got you.
Yeah.
You can't get what's already got.
That's right.
Amen.
That's it.
Amen. So, lady goes with the empty jars. Lines them up. Five doesn't say how many she had. But obviously, the prophet told her to get more than just a few. She gets her sons. She gets what's empty. Closes the door behind her. Behind her, and shut everybody up. Mm-hmm. Stop answering phones. Some of y'all need to cut your phone off.
Amen.
Some of y'all get too many calls. It is texting. Facebooking, Instagram. Need to get an instant save. But anyway, an insta prayer, an insta deliverance, an insta joy, an insta peace. You need to get insta something instead of insta what you in. Anyway, so she gets them, she shuts the door behind her. She takes this one thing of oil. She starts pouring. It starts pouring. Gets still, she puts it in up. So she's not even looking at what's coming. She's so focused on what's going on. God will always work out behind the scenes what you can see. And so she's pouring and pouring. And so she says, hand me another one. Why would she say, hand me another one? Because her jar was still full. How am I pouring out stuff and still? I mean, it's like pouring. I'm seeing the pouring, but my jar ain't getting empty. That's how God wants to bless you, Ashley. God wants to bless you to where your blessings ain't running out. See, when you're giving away, because remember, she kept putting it to the side. She didn't say, I'm going to keep it for myself. I'm going to keep it for myself. She took it and kept putting it to the side. She stopped worrying about who else had. Stop worrying about who got something you ain't got.
That's good.
And she kept going. And the oil only stopped when she ran out of doors. Mm-hmm. Your blessing will only stop when you stop trusting God. Be happy with what God has blessed you with.
Yeah.
Praise God for what you have.
Yeah.
And God will give you more. But until you're happy with what you got and realize you gave it to you, God ain't going to give you nothing else. But you got to know that little becomes much. And it's in the master's hand. I was reading this story about this little girl, Mom Darcy. The little girl was with her dad. And they were walking. She was about your age or your daughter. And she was walking through the store. Dad said, you can have anything in the store you want, baby. What do you want? And she said, I want some candy. And he said, okay, well, pick out the candy. So she's going down the aisle. He said, pick one. She wouldn't pick one. And he said, you're not going to get the candy, man? She just wouldn't say nothing. So she got to the register. And there was this big, huge bowl she said, she can have some candy, get some. And the daughter wouldn't get it. He said, baby, get you some candy. I thought you wanted some candy. She wasn't saying nothing. So all of a sudden the cashier says, get her some. So dad reaches his hand in there, Charisse. These old big mitts up in there, and grab that candy, put it in the bag, and walk into the car. And he said, baby girl, he said, I thought you said you wanted candy. You wanted candy. She said, I did, but I saw that big jar of the cashier. He said, well, the cashier offered you the candy. Why don't you get some? And she said, because your hands are bigger than mine. See, that's how God is. See, you can try to put yourself in it, and you can only get a little bit. But with God, when God puts his hands in it, it turns into way more than enough. So this daughter knew, when are you going to realize that God's in the middle of your situation?
Yeah.
When are you going to realize that even though you ain't got a lot, even though you don't have all you think you should, that God is still in the middle of your situation? And when you're willing to trust him and obey him and be faithful to him and serve his people, that God will all of a sudden give you more than enough.
Yeah.
That's the kind of God you serve. Be happy with being empty. Some of y'all ain't empty enough. Sometimes God got to take everything from you, allow everything to be taken from you in order to realize that God is in control.
Yeah.
God can't put something else in your hand if you keep holding on to this.
Yeah.
You got to let it go. God, here. Stop having a hand out and have a hand up.
Yeah.
God, fill me. God, restore me. God, build me. God, rejuvenate that dead stuff in me. Some of y'all have dreams and aspirations that sing you. You start business ventures that fail. Job opportunities didn't come to pass. You've had homes repossessed, cars repossessed, kids locked up, in and out of jail. You done had all kind of stuff. And you thought God had forgot about you. God said, I haven't forgot about you. God said, I already knew all that stuff was going to happen. I knew you were going to go through a divorce 10 years ago. I knew that wasn't going to work. I knew that was the situation. But I needed you to walk in it for you to be able to trust me. Because you wouldn't listen to me when I told you that she wasn't for you. You wouldn't listen to me when I told you he wasn't for you. You wouldn't listen to me when I told you that job wasn't the right job, that they were crooked. But you saw the base salary, and that's what you went after. God said, I knew it the whole time. Because I knew you before you was formed in your mother's womb. I know everything about you. I made you. I created you. I built you up. You look just like me. You're made in my image, in my likeness. I will no evil on you. I want nothing but my best for you. I've laid it before you. I sent my only son to die to restore you back to me. The giver of life. The giver of joy. The giver of hope. The giver of success. God said, just because you don't have it all together, God said he's in the middle of it. And God said he's ready to take you from not enough to just enough. And then boost you into more than enough. Are you willing to trust God on today? If you know that you need to be empty today, you know there's things in you that are keeping you from allowing God's anointing to pour in your life, that's blocking you from moving forward in the things of God. And you know, you're like, God, I need this released off me. I need that broken. I need that destroyed. I need that. I need all that stuff taken from me. If you know that's you this morning, stand on your feet and let me pray for you. If you know you need to be empty before God, and you want to be filled with God's abundance and God's blessing to receive all God has for you, rest to your feet. Have you not stood before? God said this. God said, if you're ashamed to confess me before men, I'm afraid to confess you before my Father. I need each one of you to come up here and stand next to me. If you bold enough to step the door, don't be ashamed of God. God ain't ashamed. Anoint your God like never before, God. Move in their lives, God. Use them, God. Anoint the gifts in them, God. Restore anything that's broken, God. Rebuild anything that's been torn down, God. God, I speak life into them, God, right now. God, I speak your power into them right now. God, I speak your anointing into them right now. I decree they are blessed. I decree they are saved. I decree they are delivered. I decree they are your children, and they are blessed above measure, God. Do it for your people this day in such a dynamic way, God, that you may be glorified. God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you, God, that you're God all by yourself. God, we thank you, God, that you're solid. Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Jireh.